are so excited that God has called us to the country of Nicaragua. We feel honored and privileged that God continues to want to use us in that country. It is our privilege to be with you guys this morning. Thank you. Thank you so much for the amazing hospitality that we have received. And we're so excited to be a part of giving a gift to Jesus, and that you chose Nicaragua makes our heart very, very happy. The clinic is an amazing place. We want it to be a place where people can come to be ministered to. You saw what we do with Latin American childcare. We want to meet the needs. We want to not only give education, we want to meet the spiritual needs, we want to meet the physical needs. And that's exactly what we want the clinic to be as well. We want it to be a place of refuge for the people. We want it to be a place where the people can go and feel the presence of God. They can feel that they're in a place where their needs will be met, maybe their spiritual needs as well as their physical needs. I'm sure you've heard some of the stories of what it is and what we want to do. And it's in a far-off land. It's very, very far. It takes about 7-8 hours by car to get to the city where we stay the night. And then the following morning, we get up and we go for about 2.5 to 3 hours on a very bad road. Where we thank you for Speed the Light. Oh, we thank you for Speed the Light. We take our vehicles and we go down to this community called La Ceiba Dudu. And as Sarah was praying and as she got this vision for this clinic and decided that it was going to be Nicaragua, and then we prayed and looked and did our research as well of what was the most needed place, and this is the place that came up. And as you go there, there might be one truck in the parking lot and the rest will be horses. It's amazing. All these people, it's like it's 50 to 100 years back. There's the horses, there's the carts, and there's just all these horses parked under the tree when the people come to church. Did anybody bring their horse today? I'm sure there's parking available. But we want this to be a place where the people can, their needs will be met. Let me tell you a story, just a real brief story, and then I'll let Levi's talk for a minute. There's so much need. There's so much need in this community. It's not like we have, the McCoys have been telling me there's 2 or 3 hospitals just in your community here in Owosso, not let alone what there is available in Tulsa. In La Ceiba Dudu, there's nothing. There's probably about 3,000 families, I think we've said, represented, and the people could come from all over the different areas, but there's nothing available. There's a doctor that comes in maybe once every 2 weeks, and he'll do some checking on some of the ongoing needs of the people. Can you imagine not being able to go to the doctor? I'm sure there's an urgent care probably just a couple miles from your home. But there was a lady I just recently made a phone call before we were coming down here to get a recent story, something to tell you. And there was a young mom who already has a couple kids, and she was pregnant and had done a little bit of her, what they call the chequeo, the prenatal care that they have to go into the city, which is 2 to 3 hours away, the big place, the big city, or maybe about 1.5 hours down the road, the dirty, bumpy, very difficult road to get to what they call a centro de salud, or just a puesto de salud, which is basically a lath house where a doctor's there and they might, or a nurse, and they might write a prescription, but there's no medicine. There's no pharmacy until you get all the way to the city of Waslala. This lady was pregnant, and she did a couple of her prenatal care. But this community, for some reason, La Ceiba Dudu, is like, they're like ostracized. I think because they're so far away that they are, they're like the despised people. Nobody wants to go down there. This community's been there for hundreds of years, and nobody wants to go there and to help them. But this lady, as she was pregnant, and all of a sudden she started to have complications, it was time for her baby to be born. And she didn't want to go in all the way up to Waslala. They thought she could make it, but they didn't want to take her because they don't always treat the people from this community very well. And so they were going to try to take her to this other place. I can't think of the town right now, the other little place an hour and a half away. And all of a sudden she started to go into labor and it started to get difficult. And they were like, oh, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? We have to take her to this puesto de salud. We have to take her down there. And they're like, no, there's not time. And she began to have more complications. And so they decided to take her to this place. But this young mom died on the way to the clinic. The baby survived, but the mom died. So you see, that's just one story of an amazing need that's out there. And I am so excited that God wants to use you guys to help meet that need. Levies will tell you a little bit about more how we want to do this. But here are our hearts. The Nicaragua is a great country. It's a beautiful country, and it's a place where God is working. And we are being able to raise up a new generation for Jesus. That's what we do. We're a part of doing these with these schools. But God wants to do so much more. Thanks.
Gloria a Dios. I was in Spanish. Yo sé, gloria a Dios. Good morning, my friends. Everything has to do with a miracle. I'm here because it's a miracle. We experienced the miracle of Christmas. We are experiencing a miracle of the possibility of this clinic. I'm so grateful for Sarah McCoy. She told me I was in the third line of that pews in there. And she was praying and she heard from God. Then she think about Haiti. And then she hear about Guatemala. But I wasn't there. It was for the people that were crying out to God in El Salvador. God help us. Because Dennis Loza, who called me and said, Levis, help us. Please help us. There's a kid here that he was cutting some sugar cane and it didn't look up and the machine cut his head. And there's no place to go in right there we bury him. There's no place to go. There's every day having accident. Bonnie was talking about that orphan kid now. You know, the enemy is so against family. So against the institution that God has created. And I think often, God, help us, God. He says in 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people repent and change their wicked ways, and they come, you know, and I forgive them, there will be change. So I go every day, God, forgive us, Lord. Give us Nicaragua for you. Working with 21 churches, 21 schools, 6,500 kids, we are believing God for the new generation for Jesus Christ in Nicaragua. That's why we are here in Oasis First Assembly. Thank you for thinking about us. A week ago, I did not know you. A month ago, a year ago, I did not know you. But God placed us together because he said, I'm going to build my church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. That is the word of God. That's what we are here for. And we are here believing God for a new generation. Here in Owasso. Who would have thought, you know, right in the, what is it called, Midwest? No. Yeah, Midwest here. So confused with geography. And then Nicaragua, Central America. So many things going on in both places, but God. That's why God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that's why we depend on him, because he's a source of everything. He's Jehovah Jireh. He's our provider. He's Jehovah. Oh, my goodness, friend. He is our warrior. He is our God. You know, so grateful to be here. So grateful to see what God has for us in the store. This year, 2016, you know, I believe God has a tremendous revival going on all around the world in the name of Jesus. And say, we're going to experience so tremendous changes because God is so good. They've been needing water. And through praying and fasting, you see, The most effective weapon of the Christian is our knee. We call it, in Nicaragua, we call it rodillón. You know, it's called about going knees. We go and pray, and guys, you call upon to me, says the Lord, and I will show you. I will respond to you. So we have prayed, we have believed, we are here for such a time as this. In Nicaragua, we need that country. I'm tired of the enemy taking with witchcraft. I'm tired of the enemy, you know, destroying the family, destroying so many people in life. And say, when we go with the good of Jesus Christ, says, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, broken chains are broken now in the name of Jesus. And now we are building this generation. You see that girl in the video? That would have been, the video was 4 years ago. She's finishing medical school. Her dad is a helper in a delivery truck. Her mom is staying with three other siblings. Now she's becoming a doctor. It's changing a generation in the name of Jesus. So the power of the transformation with the good news of Jesus Christ is really making the difference in Nicaragua. And we are grateful for the opportunity working with the poorest. It's amazing to see. Who am I? I was given away. I come from a family of five. I was given away. My own family, my father rejected me. He said I wasn't his son. He gave me away to a family in the north, in Matagalpa. And I was there for 2 years. Then my father left on a Christmas morning in 1986. He took everything by us, and my mom beat up right in the corner of the house. And my mom, she was crying. And for 2 years, we only ate menudo, you know, the soup. And you want more food? Well, we're made up, more water, and eat it. That's your meal. So I know when people are struggling. I know when people are so poor. And I tell them, if God did it with me, he can do it with you. I went ahead and forgive my father at the age of 17. I will feel the Holy Spirit. And I've been spinning and going for the glory of God, my friend. Believing God, that God will change and turn that nation for Jesus Christ. Then in Nicaragua, and believing God. You know, if God did it with me, can't do it with that little kid that just got orphaned in the Sepa Dudu. We are here for that. We are this. If I'm going to give my life to God, I wanted to give it with a meaning of changing the generation for his glory in the name of Jesus. We believe in God, believe in this generation that will conquer, and God will place our kids in a position that will empower them to do good for the nation. Corruption, here we go. In the name of Jesus, will we end it? In the name of Jesus, there in Nicaragua. My friend, God bless you, and thank you for praying for Sepa Dudu. Most they need is the word of God. And we are there for such a time as this to preach the gospel in that area in the name of Jesus. So, Pastor.
I just wish they could get excited about what they're doing. Let me tell you what's happening. This area, I was there about a year and a half ago, preached to a church that was packed with people. I mean, it was packed. People are outside looking in from the windows because there were almost no seats left inside. I've told you this before. And Bonnie, you guys came in. They were upstairs to start with our Hispanic church and came in. But the music today, just incredible job our worship team does. The music's just so good. And they've got great hearts. The music at the church in La Sebe Dudu was some of the worst music I have ever heard in my life. It was absolutely horrible. But it was some of the greatest worship. Because God listens and he hears the hearts. And he says, oh, that is so nice. It's not just about the quality. We should do the best job that we can. But it's about the heart. People love God. There were two communities in Nicaragua that they inquired about. Would you like to have a clinic here? One of the communities said, yeah, it'd be okay if y'all want to come do that. We'll be glad. That'll be fine if you want to do it. They went to La Sebe Dudu and they asked the people, would you like to have a clinic here? The people said, we've been praying for a clinic. They said, we have already started digging dirt to put something up. We don't know how to do it. We don't know what we're doing, but we're not going to just wait for something to fall in our lap. We're going to get busy and build something. And we said, well, you know, we may be able to help you out there. The Lord had spoken to Sarah McCoy about this, and she kind of initiated the thought process. And here's what's happening now. There's a company over in Wichita, Kansas. They take a shipping container, and they put inside the container all the medical equipment needed for a clinic. They call it clinic in a can. And they take it there, and they've got them. They'll have the medicines. They'll have the equipment. We're thinking that possibly one of the students who has gone through Latin America child care. I don't know if you're getting this or not. We act like we're trying to figure it out, and God goes, yeah, okay, keep going the way. I've already got this set up over here. Yeah, okay, you're about to get where I want you to get to because I've already got it planned out. Y'all will get there. I'm in control. That's what God's saying, and I've got it figured out. And you think just keep doing that. And it's very possible, very probable that one of the students who's gone through Latin America childcare, who has studied to practice medicine, will go to La Sabadudu and be the doctor for that little community and for that region and that area right there. And there are going to be people who experience better health because of this. But more importantly, they're going to encounter Jesus Christ as their Savior. I want to ask you today to give the most incredible offering you can give. If you're new to the church, you may not be aware of this. If you're a regular, you should know it. Here's my philosophy on offerings. I will never pressure you to give. I'll never make you feel awkward. I'll never say, stand up, raise your hand. Who's giving this much, that much? And if people do that, that's their prerogative. That's just not what I feel the Lord has me to do. But here's the second part of it. I will never apologize for giving you the opportunity to give. Because I know the Lord's going to speak to your heart. Let me read you a couple of scriptures real quick here. Check this one out from Psalm 41, verses 1 through 3 from the NIV. It says, blessed is he who has regard for the weak. The word regard there, the NLT says who are kind. Other places talk about who are considerate, who take action to help. Blessed is he who takes action to help the weak. And the word weak right there, it means people who may not have the ability to provide for themselves. You know, the people in La Sabadudu, Nicaragua in general, I think, but in that area specifically, they have beautiful hearts. We were there and a couple years ago, I think there were seven of us that went, six or seven of us that went. And the people said, we want to have a special meal for you. As a matter of fact, they want to have a special meal for us to the point that we had to go to two meals for Sunday lunch because both of them want to give us Sunday lunch. And they sat and they watched us eat as they prepared and sacrificed for us. These people have tremendous hearts. They have a deep passion for God. They simply don't have the resources to take care of their own needs. They just don't have it. There's no way to get the money. There's nothing to do. The Bible says, blessed is the person who is considerate for people like that. And then God gives six promises. How many of you want the promise of God? That's pretty weak. How many of you want the promise of God working in your life? Listen to this truth. God's promises are almost always conditional. You got to put yourself in the right place to receive it. It's not manipulation. It's simply being obedient to God. I got a couple things I'll say in a minute about that. Listen to the six things. The Lord, what's the first one? The Lord delivers. How many of you need the Lord to deliver you when you're in a time of trouble? One version says he rescues. He comes to their aid. The Lord delivers. That's the first promise. What's the next one in verse 2 there? The Lord what? How many of you want the protection of God in your life? He's watching over you. Not only does he protect you, but what does the next word say? He preserves. He's going to keep you. You'll be in his hands. Now, let me give you one word of understanding there. He doesn't say you'll never have trouble, but what does he say? In time of trouble, he's going to do what? He's going to deliver you. He'll preserve your life. He will bless him in the land. I think it's the New American Standard says the man who does this, he will be called blessed by his generation. He'll be blessed in the land, not surrender him to the desire of his foes. The Lord will, what's the next word, verse 3 there? Sustain him on his sick bed and restore him from his bed of illness. Charles Spurgeon, in his notes on this passage, he said there are three of the Psalms coming up to this one that all begin with this word of blessing. Blessed is the man. And the first one talks about the one who seeks God's counsel. The second Psalm that speaks of this is the one whose sin has been pardoned. And now this is the third blessing, and it says, it's the one who is forgiven and now brings forth fruit unto God available for the good of others. People who do this indicate they have been born again. Here's what he says. Such as have been made partakers of divine grace. How many of you have received the divine grace of God in your life? Say amen. Such as have received the divine grace of God receive a tender nature and are not hard against their own flesh and blood. They undertake the cause of the downtrodden. They turn their minds seriously to the promotion of the welfare of others. They do not toss them a penny and go on their way, but they inquire into their sorrows, sift out their cause, study the best way for their relief, and practically come to their rescue. Such as these have the mark of the divine favor plainly upon them, and they are surely the sheep of the Lord's pasture, as if they wore a brand upon their forehead. I love that. People who take care of the needy by their actions declare, I am a child of God. He goes on to say, first and foremost, far above all others, put together in tender compassion for the needy is our Lord Jesus Christ, who so remembered our estate that though he was rich, for our sake he became poor. Wretchedness excited his pity. Misery moved his mercy. And we have now been blessed because of his love in our lives. Christ is the example. The question is, are you a Christian? Are you a follower of Jesus? You can't do that only in word. You've got to do it in deed. You've got to show it. Now, there's often debate about good works. And are they important? Well, the Bible seems to indicate very strongly they are. But let me help you understand something. You might want to write this down or remember this phrase. Good works. What I mean by good works, I mean having compassion on those who are less fortunate, being thoughtful, kind, helpful, generous. Good works are not the path to salvation. They are the product of salvation. You can't do enough good things to earn your salvation. But I'm going to tell you something. Can I get a witness on what I'm going to say right here? When you are saved, it changes your whole outlook on life. You're no longer concerned about me and myself. You see, these promises that are given here, they have to be understood in this nature. They're not a place for us to say that I'm doing all these things just to get these benefits, but I'm doing all these things, and therefore I will receive the benefits of God. Can I tell you this? That selfishness and greed are the marks of the unregenerated soul. You get that? But consideration and generosity, that's the mark of the child of God. See, I love telling you to be generous because that may mean something for different ones of us here today. Some of your generosity may be $10. You're going to have to sacrifice to give that. Others can do 100 or 1,000 or even more. It's not about equal giving, but it's about equal commitment. Can I tell you this morning, you don't even have to worry about what everybody else gives. That's not your problem. Are you glad for that today? I don't have to be the conscience for anybody else except for me. And I have to say, God, here's what I can do. And I want to be obedient to you. Well, in case you're a New Testament kind of person, not so much in the Old Testament, let me give you the words of Jesus. Good enough quote for you? Matthew 25. Jesus is teaching here. He says this: "Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, you came to visit me.' Then the righteous will answer, 'Lord, when do we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When do we see you a stranger, invite you in, or needing clothing and clothe you? When do we see you sick or in prison, go to visit you?' And the king will reply, 'I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me.' Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, you didn't invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me.' Then they will answer, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger, needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you?' And he will reply, 'I tell you the truth, whenever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me.' Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life." A lot of people struggle with that passage, and they think, well, is Jesus teaching that our good works are what save us? No, let me go back to what I said a while ago. Good works are not the path to salvation, but they are the product of salvation. You want a real quick test today? It's not the only test, but it is an important test. You want to know if you're born again today? Here it is. Does the compassion of God dwell in you? If it does not, you're not born again. You say, "Pastor, that's awful harsh." Well, I'm just quoting Jesus, so take it up with him. I'm not saying that you earn your way into heaven. Please understand me. It is not the path to salvation, but it certainly is the product. See, here's the whole thing. Becoming a Christian is not just about saying a prayer or going through some religious calisthenics. It's about having a transformed life. And when my life is transformed, my attitude changes. And I get the mindset of Jesus where he said, you are more blessed when you give than when you receive. And so many people, even in the church world, don't understand that. They think, well, okay, but when's my turn? You've already had your turn and then some. I gave the reference to it a while ago, what Paul writes to the Corinthian church. He said, when you were poor, he who was rich became poor so that you might become rich. Can I ask you this morning, what kind of price tag are you going to put on your salvation? How much is that worth to you today? Can I tell you, if you don't have two nickels to rub together in your pocket, but you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you are rich indeed. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. So this morning we have the privilege of giving an offering as a Christmas gift for Jesus. This is where the passage where that thought came to me from, out of Matthew 25, when he said, whenever you did this for the least of these, what did he say? You did it for me. If we could ask God today, talk to Jesus and say, Lord, what do you want for your birthday? It's probably not the actual day he was born, but it's the one we celebrate, so good enough. What do you want in honor of your birth? He doesn't want any new music because he's got the angels of heaven to serenade him. Doesn't need a new red sweater vest because he's clothed in the robe of righteousness. We don't need to send him a fruitcake. But what can we do? We can give an offering today to help the least of these. And in so doing, we are giving him the best Christmas gift possible. It is my prayer today that everyone in the building will participate in this offering to the best of your ability. I don't know if y'all have noticed this or not, but I get a lot more passionate about offerings for other things more than our church, because God takes care of that. Your generosity puts us where we need to be. I would love for this offering to be the biggest offering we've ever received. Whatever you can do, do it as unto the Lord. Some people say, well, I mean, if we're going to do an offering today, is that the big part of it? This is the greatest act of worship we can have here in this room today, to give unto the Lord. If you want to write a check, you can make it out to OFA. If you want to go online this afternoon and do it through online, you can do it there. If you don't have money with you today, but you want to give something in the next 30 days or so, just write an IOU in there and say, don't have the cash today, but in the next 30 days I'll do this or whatever, and we'll try to figure that out and make that happen. The need is strong. It's probably going to cost around $75,000 or so to get the clinic down there. And that's a little bit of an estimate. It may be a little more than that, maybe a little less, but somewhere in that range. We're actually going to have to take it. They'll go down through the river system, I think is the last word I heard. And then they're probably, to get it, you've never really been on a road till you've been on the back roads of Nicaragua. To get it to the community, the thought right now is they're probably going to have to airlift it by a military helicopter across to there, because I don't know that it can, the roads could, I would hate to be driving that. It just wouldn't work. So it's a pretty crazy deal. But what a testimony of God's grace to people who need this kind of help. Give the best offer you can today. I know God will bless you for it.